Hello everyone, let peace be a lot for you, wherever you are. I am Mr. Kabanis Angasu from Jimma University School of Midwifery. Today, I will present on health professional ethics. So, until the end of this presentation, let you follow my presentation. That's my kind invitation. And also, I would like to remind you that let you subscribe my YouTube channel for gaining more teaching videos I will upload after now. Thank you. So when we come to the outlines of today's presentation, at the beginning we do have session objective, then we will have ethical philosophy of midwifery practice, then we will see informed consent and medical legal issue in general and specifically in Ethiopia. At the last, we will see compassionate care. So I hope that you will be benefited a lot from this presentation. So your attentive, intentional follow-up until the end is my kind invitation. So let you be with me. When you come to the session objective, at the end of this session, you, the followers of this video teaching, are expected to discuss ethical philosophy of midwifery practice and explain informed consent in general and the medical legal issue in Ethiopia, and you are expected to illustrate compassionate care in different perspectives. Let us come to the first part. The first part is ethical philosophy of midwifery. Before proceeding to its introduction part, let me say something what philosophy is, because it is very essential term here. You are expected to understand it first. So the word philosophy originally came from two Greek words, philo and sophia. When we say philo means love, sophia means wisdom. So philosophy means love of wisdom. So when we contextually define what philosophy is, philosophy means it is a set of belief and attitude that guides human action. So what are the beliefs of midwifery profession and the way midwifery care should be given? That is what we are going to see now. So ethical philosophy of midwifery is the general belief of midwifery professionals regarding their main area of focus and the guide for mode of profession of midwifery care. As such, midwives support pregnancy and childbirth as a state of health that is a normal physiological process and as a profound event in human's life. So, since midwives understood pregnancy and childbirth as a normal physiological process, since they believe it as a normal physiological process, the care that midwives provide is more focused on disease preventive measures and health promotive cares. In a case, if some sort of illness occurred, they also provide medical care, emergency care. Sometimes, if they do have advanced care, they can also perform surgeries. In general, the basic midwifery care is focused on provision of preventive disease preventive care and health promotive measures. The reason behind this, midwifery profession believes that pregnancy and childbirth is a normal physiological process. So what they are expected to perform in line with what philosophy of the profession asserted is that just making the normal physiological process to be optimal. That is why they focus on provision of disease preventive measures and health promotive cares. Okay, the key ethical philosophy of midwifery in general are one, continuity of care. That means since the care that midwives provide is more focused on disease preventive measure and health promotive care, these care should have to be continued even if there is some sort of illness and some sort of illness is treated. Then after, since disease preventive measures should be continued throughout human's life and since health promotive cares should be continued throughout human's life. So, midwifery profession believes in continuity of care. The other thing, informed choice. This means midwives respect this for the decision that their caretakers, either client or patients, choose. So they are more focused on giving patient-centered care. The other thing is collaboration with other health professionals. Since provision of health care is a teamwork, midwives believe in collaboration in working with other health professionals, whether other health professionals may be nurses, doctors, pharmacists, whoever other health professionals. So, depending on the nature of health care, that it is teamwork, they also believe in teamwork. So, how should midwives look themselves and provide care? Let us answer this. So, midwives have a responsibilities to themselves as persons of moral worth, including duties of moral self-respect and preservation of integrity. So, midwives provide care for women and childbearing families with respect for cultural diversity, while also working to eliminate harmful practices within those same cultures. That means midwives take into consideration the diversity of human beings and also their respect for whatever culture, attitude, practices people to have. So, it is dependent on respect for human dignity. Let us come to the values in midwifery practice. What do midwives work for? What do they give price for? What do midwives consider as important thing? Midwifery care is holistic, grounded in understanding of social, emotional, cultural, spiritual, psychological, and physical experiences of women and based upon the best available evidence. So, midwifery care provision is evidence-based practice. So, midwives values all aspects of their client's humanity. That means midwifery care is holistic. So, it is grounded in understanding of the social. What do the social aspects of their client look like? What about the emotional? Emotional reaction do their client shows. So, they prepare themselves appropriate response to what emotional reaction their client or all caretakers may exhibit. They also give respect for whatever culture their caretakers do have, and also they respect the religion, all spiritual practices of their caretakers, the other psychological, physical experience of women. So, by the time midwives provide midwifery care, they respect for each and every aspect of their client humanity. So, midwives trust and respect for women and their capabilities in childbirth. In addition, values of midwifery practice include ensuring that all patients feel safe as a result of midwife's care. And also, they value complying with all trust policies and practices. I mean, midwives strictly align what they practice with the best evidence practice available. The other thing, midwives also value for increasing patient safety concerns and providing all necessary care. The other thing, they also give value for keeping an open mind to learning new things and new understandings. I mean, since as technologies updated, there are also a lot of things that may come newly. So, midwives keep open mind for learning new things. The other thing, midwives also values, midwives values include fairness, equality, and respect for human dignity. that is all about the ethical philosophy of midwifery care. We have seen the ethical philosophy of midwifery care and the values of midwifery care. Now let us proceed to informed consent. So as you may ever know, informed consent is the process required for most healthcare procedures. And in healthcare setting, informed consent allows healthcare seekers to participate in their own healthcare. It enables caretakers, clients or patients. By the time when I say clients, they are customers, they don't have any sort of medically diagnosed illness, but they may come to health facility for screening service or for gaining disease preventive measures, health promotive measures, whatever, but they don't have medically diagnosed disease. But when I say patient, they do have some sort of illness and medically diagnosed disease. So informed consent enables clients or patients in general, health caretakers, to decide which treatment do they do or do not want to receive. The other thing, informed consent is a collaborative decision-making process. It is an ethical and legal obligation of healthcare providers. So informed consent is shared decision between healthcare seekers and healthcare provider. Informed consent is when healthcare provider explains a process of treatment to their caretakers before they agree to it. So informed consent enables the client or patient to ask questions for further understanding and to accept or deny the treatment options that healthcare provider may propose for them. So in a healthcare setting, the process of informed consent includes considering the following essential components. The first thing, what should be considered, is the ability of the client or the patient to make decision. So before proceeding to informing what procedure or treatment options is proposed for the patient, and just in order to go just for taking informed consent, healthcare providers should have to consider whether the client or the patient they are working with is able to make their own decision. The other thing, explanation of information needed to make the decision. The third is client's understanding of the information. Do the client have ability to understand what information provide him or not? The other thing, the client or patient voluntary decision to get treatment. That mean informed consent. That mean the consent or the agreement that the healthcare seeker decide should be on their voluntary decision. No need to enforce them to just agree with what healthcare provider proposes for them. What types of procedure need informed consent? The following are examples of scenarios that require written informed consent, but just what I am going to present here is only the example. So many more procedures are there that need informed consent. So for example, most surgeries require a written informed consent. Electrotransfusion, anesthesia, radiation, chemotherapy, and some advanced medical tests like biopsy. So these examples I have presented here, they do have a high chance, yes, comparatively, some significant chance to lead to some adverse effect. If those adverse effects may occur, the healthcare provider will not be questionable, because just what the healthcare provider is expected to do is just to inform. We will see what the procedure is going to be done for them, its benefit, its risk, what possible side effects may occur. So since just the example I've listed here may lead into some adverse or negative consequence, in that case the patient should have to decide whether he choose to be at risk for developing that sort of adverse effects or not. So we will see in deep after now. So what information should be given for healthcare seeker? An informed consent agreement should include the following information. The first, diagnosis of the client or patient condition. That means what real problem do the patient have? The other thing, the name and the purpose of the proposed procedure and treatment to be given. The other thing, the benefit, the risk, alternative procedure and the treatment. For alternative, when I say alternative to the proposed procedure or treatment. The other thing, the benefits and risks of each alternatives. This all information should be given for the healthcare seekers in the language and also to the level that the healthcare takers can understand. The other thing is, what is the importance of signing informed consent? So the first one is to empower the client or the patient to decide on the care of their choice, just to enable them to decide for themselves. The other thing is to legally protect the healthcare providers if in case adverse effect occurred on the client or patient as a result of the procedure done or given. That means, if for example, if a healthcare provider didn't have taken informed consent before beginning the procedure, and in a case if that person may die, the relatives of that person may legally question the healthcare provider that my relative is dead due to the wrong procedure you have done on him, something like that. In this case, if the healthcare provider didn't taken the informed consent first, that person will be accused for that. So that means that it's criminal, so that person may be kept in jail. So the purpose or the importance of gaining informed consent first is to legally protect healthcare provider if in case adverse effect occurred to the client, that healthcare provider will not be questionable. So when the informed consent should be signed, just as you can easily understand, the informed consent form should be completed and signed before the procedure done or treatment given. What does signing informed consent indicate? When the healthcare seekers sign informed consent, it means they received all the relevant information about the procedure from their healthcare provider. The other thing, it indicates that the healthcare seekers understood the information. The other, it indicates that the healthcare seekers use the information to make their own decision. In addition, informed consent indicates that the healthcare seekers agreed or consented to get the treatment or procedure to be done. So, once the healthcare seeker signed the form, that means once the client or the patient signed the informed consent form, their healthcare provider can move forward with the procedure or giving the treatment. Okay, who should sign informed consent form? So, the patient or client themselves can sign the informed consent, but if their age is greater than or equal to 18 years old. This is in terms of Ethiopian constitution, but in other different countries, they may have their own rule. So it depends in different countries' situation. So the other thing, the parent or the guardians need to give consent on behalf of the client or patient if age is young, less than 18 years. The other, some countries allow teens, that mean people whose age is less than 18 years, just if they are emancipated, if they are legally authorized to decide for themselves, and if they are married, if they became parents or in military, just to provide their own consent. So it depends on the rule and regulation of each country's have. The other thing, a person of the client or patient choice, if they like to let another person make their future medical decisions, they can fill out a form called advance directive. This is in a case, for example, if certain former patient do have a medical doctor or healthcare provider, a son or daughter, and if he considers that more than the patient himself, so his children, either son or just the daughter, knows each and everything about health, and if he considered that those people who he or she just chose know more better than me and decide more better than me, just in that kind of situation, just a form called advanced directive will be filled, and then it is possible in this case. The other thing, another person can make informed consent if the client or patient can't provide consent. For example, if a patient is unconscious, or if the patient may have advanced Alzheimer's disease, I mean long-term memory loss. So in that kind of case, a person accompanying that patient is expected to provide informed consent. Let us see the difference between informed consent and implied consent. So implied consent is a type of informed consent where the consent is suggested or implied by the patient's action. So implied consent is not explicitly stated or written down. For example, if you may have a fever and visit healthcare provider, your visit implies that you want treatment. So compared to informed consent, implied consent is less formal. For example, when we consider the example here, if a patient who have fever and visit health care provider, his visit suggests that that patient is intended to be treated for the situation he do have. So in this case, just the healthcare provider is expected to tell him what medication should be given and the risk factors that medication do have, and the other alternative medications that can be given, whatever it is. But after then, the patient can choose the one that suits him, but no need to sign informed consent. So, yes, I have seen before, implied consent doesn't need to be legally recorded, no need to make it written consent. So, let us consider the next. When is informed consent not required? Informed consent is not always required in emergencies, in life-threatening issues, because no time for taking informed consent. But in this case, if the situation permits, for example, if certain patient maybe may have certain accident, and if that person may do have his own relative with him, blood relatives, that person may give consent if the situation permits. But it is not necessity, it is not requirement. But if the patient is in life-threatening situation, the healthcare provider can perform the necessary life-saving procedures without consent. So in emergency cases, it is not must to gain informed consent before providing healthcare treatment or whatever procedure it may be. So in this case, the focus is to try to save the life of the victim. So in emergency case, it is not always to have informed consent before providing whatever treatment, depending on the need of the patient. That is it. So we completed all about informed consent. If you may have any unclarity, whatever question you may have, you can write on the comment part and I will react to it. I will give you answer. Let us proceed to medical legal cases. So medical legal case is any case of injury or ailment where the intending healthcare provider, after history taking and the clinical examination, considers that investigation by law enforcement agencies are warranted to ascertain circumstances and fix responsibility regarding the said injury or ailment according to law. So in this case, for example, if certain patient do have some sort of accident, the healthcare provider takes just history, physical examination, that means their own care process. So they also provide what care they are expected to provide. In addition to that, if they consider treating only the medical issues the patient have is not enough because his right is abused in some way. So in this case, legal personnel should have to work with the situation to solve or just to manage the issue from its root. So in this case, just medical doctors or healthcare providers may need to consult law personnel. That is the case in which medical legal case is considered. So medical legal cases are an integral part of medical practice that is frequently encountered by health professionals. So proper handling and accurate documentation of this case is of prime importance to avoid legal complications and to ensure that the close relative receive an entitled benefit in a case if the victim may be died, whatever. So in that case, what health care providers should have to do, just we will see the situation that should be considered as a medical legal issue after this slide. But what health care provider is expected to do is just handling and proper handling and accurate documentation of the case. So each and every information that health care provider documents serves as a witness for the victims. So in this case, what healthcare provider expected to do is just proper handling and accurate documentation of the patient information. That is it. The other, when we see the example of medical legal cases, the first one, domestic violence and child abuse. So in these cases, this issue should be dealt with just legal personnel. Just the healthcare provider should have to give care from health perspective, from their own professional perspective. In addition to that, they need to consult legal personnel to deal with the issues. I mean, to punish, just to take necessary measurement depending on the situation from a legal perspective. So in this case, healthcare provider are expected to provide just the care that they are expected to provide depending on their professional perspective, including just in addition to providing necessary care, they are expected to handle the patient's information accurately. Accurate documentation is must. After then, they should have to guide the victim to visit legal personnel, legal organization. The other, in case if traffic accident occur, the same thing. Case of poisoning, that means if someone has given poison to someone, and if that person just affected by the poison that given for the victim, in this case, the situation should be considered as medical legal issues. I mean, the healthcare provider should have to give necessary health care measure. After then, depending on the situation, legal personnel may be consulted, but in this case, just three things expected from healthcare providers. The first thing, giving necessary healthcare intervention. The other thing, accurately handling and accurately documenting each and every information that is needed for legal process. The other thing, either directly consulting the healthcare, the legal personnel, or directing the victim to consult to the legal personnel. That is it. Criminal abortions, attempted suicide, case of asphyxia as a result of hanging, if someone may hang someone just as such. The other, strangulation, the same. Suffocation, it may be just by using just compounds such as carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, whatever gas it may be. The other thing, case of drug overdose, this is the common problem that may occur in a healthcare setting. So each and every healthcare personnel who provide medication should have to strictly focus on what dose is prescribed for the specific patient. So they should have to look for what precautions measures should be taken, just right patient, right dose, right route, right frequency, whatever. So they should have to stick to their practice, and also just they should have to consciously look at what medications they are giving, what dose in what frequency, in what route, whatever, what side effect. So if patient may be affected by drug overdose, drug overdose can kill person. So in this case, a person who may prescribe inappropriate dosage and who may administer the dose will be asked. So they may be put to jail. So punishment is jail. So they should have to take each and every procedure they perform cautiously. The other thing, sexual offense and that brought to medical emergency. It is obviously now, yes. Forensic science should be responsible for that kind of issue. So it is considered as medical legal case. So medical legal report is a structured and a formal vehicle for communication between doctors. When I say doctors, all healthcare providers and the legal system. So medical legal report just start with request. So the requests for medical legal report are common and originate from requests for medical legal report are common and originate from a variety of sources such as police, lawyers, government courts, insurance companies, or patients themselves. So once prepared, medical legal report may be used in criminal or civil proceedings with consequences for the patient, the doctor, third parties, and the judicial system. So, in view of these potential implications, they must be prepared with accuracy, with diligence, and the basic understanding of the legal principles. So when we come to see the contents of a medical legal report, proper request and informed consent are essential prerequisites to commencing a report preparation. So the healthcare personnel, whether doctor or other healthcare providers, just they should have to prepare the medical legal report depending on the proper request and the informed consent gotten from the victim. So what are the contents of structured format incorporating the, what are the contents of medical legal report? It includes structured format incorporating the following elements. One is background information, then medical history, physical examination finding, the specimens obtained, treatment provided, and healthcare provider's opinion, just depending on the patient's problem. So the prerequisite, the first one is request of medical legal report. So the medical legal report should be directed specifically to the most senior healthcare provider who was involved in health clinical management of the patient. So the request should specifically state who should write the report and the name and also preferably the date of birth of the patient, the time and the date of any accident, the purpose of the report, and any specific issues that need to be addressed, and request should be accompanied by signed statement of consent completed by the patient or the legal guardian, allowing release of medical information. Just when we consider the consent part, consent for the release of medical information to third party must be obtained prior to medical legal report being sent out to prevent unintended release without consent. So, for the consent to be valid, the following criteria must be met. What are those criteria? The first one, the patient or the legal guardians must be competent to provide the consent. The other thing, it must be informed. When on the first part, the patient or their guardians must be competent to provide it. That means, as we have seen, the 4 points on who can provide informed consent. The first one, just let you remind it. The first one is the one who provides the informed consent. must be greater than 18 years old. After then, if those patients are not greater than or equal to 18 years, their legal guardians must provide the informed consent. The other, just you can revise from our previous slide. The second, it must be informed, that is, the patient must have a clear understanding of the implications of the release of the information. The third, the consent must be specific, and also it must be freely given. So that the consent must be given freely. The other thing is release of privileged medical information in a medical legal report without valid consent is unethical and also illegal. So the validity of the informed consent must be taken into consideration. When you come to the format to be used for reporting medical legal issue, the medical legal report must be directed either by the personal preference of the author or by the requirements of the legal processor requesting the requesting agency. So each medical legal report must include the date on which the report was prepared and the name of the person to whom the report is directed, the full name, date of birth and hospital unit, record number of the subject, which we call medical record number, and identification of the author. So these should include the practitioners, that means the healthcare providers, full name, practicing address, current employment, and qualification. So the report must primarily be prepared from the original notes taken during the time the medical doctor or healthcare provider has provided care for the patient. So let us come to see the contents of medical legal report one by one. The first part is background. So data such as the time, date, place, and the reason of the examination, I mean the reason of the clinical examination, and detail of the nature and extent of the healthcare provider's involvement in the case should be written in the report first. The other, a brief account of the alleged offense, that means the offense that the patient said without any further investigation to confirm it is rightness or not. So, brief account of the alleged offense, that means brief account of just what the patient said that was occurred on him or her. And the source of that information should will also be included. I mean, if the patient himself said someone offended me as such as that, such kind of accident, redraw me, whatever. Just if the patient responded it, the patient said it. If a patient, I mean, if a patient is unconscious and can't provide any information, a person who brought him or the patient is a companion should give the information, and that the source of the information should be recorded. The other, a specific comment should be made concerning the provision of the consent. The second content of medical legal report is the medical history. So, a brief account of any relevant medical conditions in the past is appropriate to be written. So, the other thing, the third component is physical examination of the patient. So, what components should be in count just to be included under a physical examination. So the comment on the general presentation of the subject should be included in the medical legal report. The other, the emotional, psychiatric, and illegal, I mean intellectual state and the effect of alcohol or other drugs should be described. So I mean, if the patient just hurted because of hurted or injured because of the psychotic problem he do have, just because of alcohol or whatever, that should be focused on, and that should be information regarding this issue should be recorded. So specific attention should be given to sites of particular interest in the case. For instance, just genital anal examination in rape case, or and specifically attention should be given to the area of the body that is injured, and deep investigation should be written on a deep finding. If there are any difficulties or eliminations encountered during examination, for example, if the patient is not cooperative enough, and if just withdraw his consent for to be examined, that kind of information should be noted. I mean, for example, if the patient may be rapid and if the healthcare provider proposed to do just perineal examination, and if the patient refused to be examined, yes, that should be noted. The patient was asked to be examined her genital area, but she refused to be examined. So we haven't gotten any finding, any physical finding around it because we haven't seen it. So this kind of information should be included. When we consider the fourth component, it is all about the fourth component is all about specimens for investigation. So detail of all specimens obtained should appear in the medical legal report, including the finding after specimens investigation. The other comments should also be made regarding the time and the date of transfer of specimens to the care of another person. The other, this ensures that the continuity of evidence can be proven later in the court. I mean, if someone's specimen is taken for examination and that if that result of the examination is not came back, and the person who is writing medical legal report haven't gotten the result of the investigation, just the progress should be indicated there. Just we have sent such specimens, but the result of investigation is not reached for us. So that should be also included. The other fifth component is all about opinion. So it is advisable to distinguish, if possible, between fact and opinion. So the fact being what was seen or done, and the opinion being what was inferred or assumed. That means, for example, if certain patient or victim may be injured on head, and just the healthcare provider just characterize it, what the depth of injury, the length is, and just including such kind of evidence is called fact. I mean, that finding is really seen on the patient. And for example, if we consider opinion, for example, if certain patients do have the findings that indicate that he has been, yes, he had drunken alcohol, and if he do have a smell of alcohol, and he just injury is occurred on him that suggests that injury is occurred as a result of falling down, and if the doctor include just serious injury on such body, but it seemed like it occurred as a result of falling down, as a result of being under control of the alcohol. So this is opinion. So when we say fact is what really we have seen on our patient. Opinion is what we can infer from what we have seen on the patient. That is it. So it should be differently written. Opinion evidence will often come under particular scrutiny by the reader of the report and may be publicly tested in court. I mean, publicly stated in the court. So the author's experience and expertise are fundamental to the weight given by the court for the opinion. So when we see the medical legal issue in Ethiopia, some examples of medical legal issue in Ethiopia include just the first one. All forms of euthanasia are illegal. When you say euthanasia, it is peaceful death. So if a person may ask to die peacefully by gaining certain medications, whatever, it is not allowed in Ethiopia. For example, Article 1 of Principles of Medical Practice says that no physician can take life deliberately as an act of mercy, even at the direct request of the patient or patient family. So euthanasia is not legalized in Ethiopia. The other, Article 551 of the Penal Code of Federal Democratic of Ethiopia allows termination of pregnancy under five specific conditions. The other, just a sort of example, Article 545 of Criminal Code asserts intentional termination of pregnancy is punishable except as provided under Article 551 APA. So there are other examples. For example, Article 565 talks about female circumcision. So I mean, if a person who just if their parent, if they allowed their female children to be circumcised, what amount of punishment should be for them, the one who performs, what sort of punishment should be, how many years, what money payment, whatever it is already indicated there. So for further clarification, for further understanding, you can download Constitution of Ethiopia and just you can read on it. So others are also here. Injuries caused by negligence, yes, it is written on Article 559, whatever. So for example, all about malpractice, illegal practice also here. For example, unlawful exercise of health professionals is specifically for health professionals. For example, if they try to perform procedures that is beyond their capacity, I mean beyond their scope of practice of their current qualification, it is punishable. So it's already described there. So they should have to consult it, they should have to understood it, they should have to practice as per as the law. So in addition to that, malpractice also here, that means the failure to serve as per the standard. Just it is also punishable. Just you can read and understand by yourself. So when we come to legal issues specific to midwifery practice, it mainly concerned with domestic violence, sexual violence, abortion, issues of changing someone's newborn baby with some other person's baby, and the issue of a legal practice and malpractice is what legal issue we can encounter in midwifery practice. So midwifery practice, I mean midwifery practitioners should have to be just aware enough what legal concern they may encounter in their professional practice, and they should have to do as far as the legal, as far as the rule and regulation. So the fact of each crime will be taken seriously and punishment made as per as outlined in the country's constitution. That is it. So now let us proceed to compassionate care. When we come to concepts of compassionate care is at the heart of midwifery care provision. So, compassionate care is all about striving to meet the individual needs of patient or client and striving to respect for client and patient privacy and dignity, and it is all about striving to meet effective leadership in care provision. When we see the overall image of compassionate care means all about showing our readiness to serve our caretakers and acting in that manner. So I mean giving ourselves or submitting ourselves to our provision, I mean profession, as per us that enable us to provide a care that maximizes our patient satisfaction. So I mean it is all about being empathic. So I mean we should have to understand the problem of our patient as our own problem, and it is all about striving to give care to solve the real problem of our patient. That is it. So delivering care with compassion and empathy is vital to all healthcare workers regardless of their specific field. So this is especially important for midwives, as the entire work of midwives is with women, and in very severe level pain, where compassionate care is above all of great importance. So compassionate care is very vital for midwives. So to provide compassionate care, we need to practice good manners, show personal interest into our patient, and take the time to think about what your client or patient have been taught, and it is all about understanding, striving to understand what our patient thinks, what is in the mind of the patient. So always acknowledge your patient's feeling, and the other thing is take time to care for your needs as healthcare provider. So when we come to see looking each component in detail, practicing good manner includes always be polite, even if you may be emotionally disturbed. In any case, be calm in front of your patient. So, being polite is one quality to practice compassionate care. The other thing, be sure to show your patient a warm smile. So you should have to welcome. You should have to show your patient just a welcoming face. The other thing, make eye contact when you speak with your patient. If you don't make eye contact with your patient by the time you are speaking to your patient thinks that this person is not giving concern for what I am talking with him. So just I tell him the secret of my problem. So in that case, just your patient will not tell you their true problem, the real problem. Then you miss the patient's problem. You can't identify what real problem do your patient have, so that you can't able to identify, able to diagnose the patient's problem. So your all effort will be meaningless. The other thing, avoid right body language. That mean just don't show your patient that you are hurry. Your body language shouldn't have to show your patient that you don't need to have much more time with your patient. The other thing, every time you meet a new patient or a new member of your patient's family, introduce yourself and briefly explain what you do. The other, be good communicator and use positive body language to establish trust with your patient. So let us proceed to the next. The second thing we should have to do in order to provide compassionate care is showing personal interest to our patient. So make a light conversation about the patient's life to establish trust. That means let you ask about what profession of your patient is, how is their life condition is, whatever it is, just depending on your patient's condition. And also be an interested listener to your patient's concern. So you need to be a good listener. If you listen to them, your patient will tell you their real problem, considering that this person is more concerned with what I am complaining. So he will act upon what my real problem is, and my real problem will be solved. So you need to show that you are interested listener to your caretakers. The other thing, your patient will have an overall more positive experience if they feel like they are treated more friendly. So if you show interest into your patient will trust you. If your patient trusts you, they will tell you what real problem do they have. After then, if you hear the real problem of your patient, you can proceed to the next measurement you are expected to do. After then, you will be enabled, empowered to diagnose the real problem that your patient have. If you identify the real problem your patient have, just you can provide appropriate treatment, appropriate care. After then, your patient will be healed. That means your care became effective. That is it. So we should have to show personal interest to our patient. The other, we should have to take time to think about what our patient thinks. So, knowing about what the patient thinks helps to eliminate miscommunications and enable us to give care focused on our patient's need. So, we should have to aware what is in the mind of our patient. We should have to think over it depending on what our patient show us. The other thing, acknowledging our patient's feeling. For example, it only takes a few seconds to express your empathy. That means to express that you understood the patient's problem as yours. For example, it is often best to say "I understand" rather than "I know" statements. So when you say "I understand," you are telling your patient that you understood the real feeling that your patient is feeling, and also the difficulty of the feeling that your patient is really feeling. So you should have to say as such. By the time you say "I understand what you are feeling, the difficulties of the situation you are in," that person, I mean, your patient perceives you as you are a concerned person with the problem, so they will trust you. So that can cause some to feel, I mean, if you say, I know, that kind of thing cause a person to feel dismissed rather than inquired. So if you said, I understood, just it shows that you are emphasized to what they are complaining. So a statement, for example, saying such a like statement is good. A statement more along lines with understanding the patient's problem as yours is just, I understand that this is a difficult situation and I can only imagine how you must feel. Would you better to say that? It's good to say. The other, if your patient express pain, say, I am sorry to hear that. Cute expressions of empathy will help increase their comfort level. The other, you need to take time to care for your own needs. I mean, healthcare providers have needs too, as every other person. So, compassion fatigue can be common among those who help others every day. So, you should have to care for yourself so that you should get proper sleep and nutrition to have your brain cope with stress. The other, you need to get self-refreshment time, safe. And I mean a refreshment that is riskless. For example, if you consider drinking alcohol as refreshment, that is not good. Chewing gum as refreshment, it is not safe. It is riskful. So I mean, if you consider drinking alcohol, chewing gum, smoking whatever as sort of refreshment, just you will be fell into addiction after then. You be addicted, just you will be lack your freedom. Okay, the other thing is building harmonious relationship and trust with your coworkers. So if you do have harmonious relationship with your coworkers and if you trust each other, just having interaction with your coworkers itself gives you satisfaction. So practicing such kind of act is good. So you need to care for yourself by gaining proper sleep and nutrition, by having safe refreshment, and by building harmonious relationship with your co-workers. So the other thing, you need to be satisfied with whatever you work, and just you should have to be feel free. That is it. Let us proceed to the next. Okay, the next is principles and standards of compassionate care. So the principles of compassionate care includes giving patients a positive experience. Okay. The other, having proficient skill. The other, respecting privacy and your patient's dignity. The other, providing safer care for all at all. Other, practically evaluate the quality of the patient care to improve further. And also, working in partnership with other stakeholders, attracting high caliber health workforce, avoiding inequalities in healthcare provision, putting patient safety first, meeting the individual needs of patient, developing effective leadership, and developing a woman-centered maternity service, delivering the highest standards of mother and baby care. So, if you practice all these qualities, it means that you are providing compassionate care. If you provide compassionate care, you can address the patient's real problem. That means you can identify the true problem that your patient came with. If you identify the true problem your patient is have, you can treat it correctly. If you treat it correctly, your patient's progress will be positive. That means it may be healed, cured totally, or improved. So if you have achieved that, your care provision will be effective. So that's good. You should let us always practice these standards and principles of compassionate care. Thanks. Let us proceed to the next. So in general, when we consider the benefits of compassionate care helps to build a positive environment, intimacy, and trust between healthcare professionals and their caretakers. So compassionate care enables care providers to identify the real problem of the patient and to treat it. So that compassionate care makes health care provision effective. This is what I have said before. So as a conclusion, compassionate care is the most precious asset of midwives. So midwives always expected to practice compassionate and respectful care, and also they should have to consider compassionate care provision as a diamond, as a gold, as very prestigious thing. So they should have to consider compassionate care as the most precious asset, the most precious resource they have for provision of effective care. That is it. Let you take this as a good message, and let you remember me by saying the word compassionate care is the most precious asset of midwives. Thank you. If you practice this kind of care provision, you will be satisfied throughout your life. So if you are satisfied throughout your life, that is the goal of living through life. That is it. Let us see only short list of barriers of compassion care. So barriers of compassionate care include lack of interest and motivation, disbelief in compassionate care, and exhaustion. Whatever barriers of providing compassionate care may be encountered, healthcare providers should use certain strategies to overcome barriers and always maintain providing compassionate care. If they do not practice compassionate care, each and every care they provide will be meaningless, not effective at all. So they should have to be conscious on what strategies they can use to prevent, to avoid compassionate care, and they should have to maintain providing compassionate care throughout their professional life. Okay, just let us come to the last part of our today's portion. So compassionate fatigue is a condition characterized by emotional and physical exhaustion, leading to diminished ability to emphasize or feel compassion for others. So compassionate fatigue is described as the negative cost of caring. It is sometimes referred to as secondary traumatic stress. So compassionate fatigue means if someone strives to provide compassionate care throughout just his daily activity, just that person may emotionally and physically just tired. So if tiring occurs, that kind of person should have to take care of himself, just as I have said on the previous slide, and they should have to cope up with, they should have to maintain their compassionate care again. Also, compassionate fatigue may be encountered and said sometimes referred to as secondary traumatic stress. So in this case, if for example, if a patient, the healthcare provider have been caring for, maybe died, in that case just the healthcare provider may be traumatized. So in that case, compassionate fatigue is said as secondary traumatic stress. Whatever it is, the healthcare provider should be expert on the way how they can cope up with compassionate fatigue, solve it timely, and maintain your compassionate care again. Okay, thank you. But whatever compassionate fatigue midwives may face, not only midwives, medical doctors and nurses, physiologists, whatever, others. So, physiotherapists, psychiatrists, whatever health care discipline it may be, they should continue provision of compassionate care by using different mechanisms of coping with the fatigue. Okay, just the most last one is demonstration of compassionate care. So, there are different ways of showing compassion, including be compassionate for yourself first. So the best way to learn how to be compassionate toward others is to be compassionate with yourself. So let you practice being compassionate for yourself first. After then, you will be compassionate for others. The other, be expert to communicate effectively, both verbally and inverbally, non-verbally. Other thing, touch and massage the shoulder of your patient is if appropriate as such. Just it is as part of providing psychological support. The other encourage your healthcare seekers to forward what they feel. Be good listener. Encourage your care seekers to tell you whatever they feel, whatever problem do they perceive within their mind. So encourage them to tell you. The other, express yourself at the beginning of your conversation. Express who you are and what activities, what roles, what responsibilities do you undertake there. The other thing, be kind. Show kindness and respect your patient's privacy. Don't show their private body part to others. So just by practicing, what I have listed here are only the example. They are not only these. So always let us demonstrate compassionate care. Let us show respect for our patient. Let us show empathy for our patient, and let we able to identify the real problem our patient have. Let us then propose appropriate intervention, and let we provide effective care for our patient. After then, yes, we will be very successful. Even after then, the satisfaction we will gain is very worthful, trustworthy. Thank you. Let us proceed. We have finished our today's lesson. Just let me remind you our second objective. We have seen, ethical philosophy of medical practice. We have seen informed consent and the medical legal issue in Ethiopia and the medical legal case in general. The other thing, we have seen different aspects of compassionate care, starting from the concepts of compassionate care, principles and the standards of compassionate care, benefit of compassionate care, compassionate fatigue, and demonstration of compassionate care. So let you revise it, let you use these references for further reading, for further understanding. If you may have any question, I'll let you write it on my just below my this YouTube this video on comment part. I will give you answer. So thank you so much for your attention, for following us, for following this presentation until its end. Thank you so much. And also I would like to remind you to subscribe my YouTube channel to gain much more attractive and useful teaching videos, and also prepare recreational videos, and you can use them. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much again and again. I would like to remind you that providing compassionate care enables healthcare providers to provide effective care. So always let us provide compassionate and respectful care for our patients. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.